So our topic tonight, we're in Romans 8. We're going to be the second half of Romans 8. We did the first half sort of last week. And the topic is future glory, present help. We're going to read Romans 8, 18 to 39, and I have three girls that are going to read it. So if you three would come up, because I need you to speak into this thing, that'd be awesome. Let's see. So who has the first 18 to whatever? Okay.
For I consider that suffering of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is going to be revealed to us. For the creation eagerly waits with anticipation for God's sons to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to be futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in the hope that the creation itself will also be set free from the bondage to decay into the glorious freedom of God's children. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together with labor pains until now. Not only that, but we ourselves who have the Spirit as the first fruits, we also groan within ourselves, eagerly waiting for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. Now in this hope we were saved, but hope that is seen is not hope, because who hopes for what he sees? Now if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with patience.
In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groans that words cannot express. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints in accordance with God's will. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be confirmed to the likeness of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, he also glorified.
What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, then who is against us? He did not even send his own Son, but offered him up for us all. How will he not also with him grant us everything? Who can bring the accusation against God's elect? God is the one who is justified. God is the one who justifies. Who is the one who condemns? Christ is the one who died, but even more, has been raised. He also is the right hand of God and intercedes for us. Who can separate us from the love of Christ? Can affliction or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, because of you, we are being put to death all day long. We are counted as to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other thing created will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Jesus Christ our Lord.
Thank you, ladies. With my dyslexia, it's always nice to have other people reading out loud instead of me. So, and to have it show up on the video, like if I have you guys read from there, it can't be heard over the video. So that's why we got jumped through some hoops there. But Romans in general, I think every speaker so far, what, on week 4, has said the same thing, which is Romans is such a big book, and I did a Bible study one time in Romans for 6 months, and I know other people, other speakers have said same, long, even longer. And it ended up being kind of funny that both Christina and I chose Romans 8 for our topics, and she did the first half, and I had done the second half, and we didn't plan it that way. Then when I was talking to Steve Hodge, he mentioned how we both were talking about how we felt that, you know, the whole Bible, obviously very important, God's word is created, but like so much of our Christian faith and rules and what we need to follow and what we need to do and our hope and our glory is all in Romans 8. So it's such a heavy book. And we are going to break it down a lot smaller than that big section those girls read so wonderfully for us. So, all right. So looking at just the beginning, Paul is reminding us in Romans 8 that we have a future hope of glory. But he also reminds us that we'll have to wait for it. And we'll be waiting around for that future glory. But while we're waiting, we won't be without help. We have hope and help in the Holy Spirit. And he also reminds us that there is suffering and that we're going to have to go through suffering. And my dad belongs to a church that is very, what we consider prosperity gospel. And that just really kind of boils down to people that seem to think that suffering isn't, like once you're a Christian, you don't suffer. And that is nowhere in the Bible. In fact, multiple times in the Bible, we are told we will suffer. And it is a struggle for my dad then when, in his words, good things happen to bad people. He doesn't think it's fair. And it actually hurts his faith a lot. And I feel really bad because I feel like I can't get through to him to say, like, Dad, I'm sorry, but, like, suffering is going to happen. And suffering is not when the bad guy gets an 8-point buck and you don't. But in my dad's mind, that is suffering. So, in Romans 8:18, it says, the suffering of this present time. And when I was studying this, that kind of word, this present time, was just like bouncing around in my brain. Because I think often when I'm studying through the word, like a lot of times in the word, it'll say, especially in the Old Testament where I've been in, like Isaiah and Jeremiah, like until this time, until this day, it still is. And I think about how long ago that was written. And then I think, is it still today? Like, I don't know. My brain just does that. And so when I was thinking about this present time, I mean, Paul's writing in the time he's in. But every time throughout all of time so far, there has been a present time that is full of suffering. It isn't a specific time. He doesn't just say, this present time in, like, you know, right after Jesus was crucified is, or, you know, going to be suffering. Or, hey, you know what, in the year 2020, there will be suffering. We saw that, right? But it's always, terrible thing occurred when Adam and Eve made that choice, right? When they made that choice to take that bite and learn what sin really was. And ever since then, there's always been that present time of trouble. Because we're all broken and sinful people. And nothing on this side of heaven is ever going to be perfect. So we can enjoy the really good times, but they're never going to be perfect. And most everybody in the Bible that we look at has suffered in one way or another. So if you want to turn to 2 Corinthians 4:17, you can, but it's also going to be up here on the screen, so you can read it there. 2 Corinthians 4:17 and 18, for our momentary light affliction is producing for us absolutely incomparable eternal weight of glory. For we do not focus on what we see, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. There are reasons for suffering. They help us grow. They make us stronger in our faith. They make us cry out to God. They make us, you know, grow. They make us study. They make us learn. And every time we go through something, we become stronger. It helps us to have a hope for the future. Glory isn't revealed this side of heaven. Future glory is freedom from sin. It's a freedom we do not have now. But we will be. We will have that. freedom from sin. That is an amazing glory, an amazing hope for the future, and something we have to look forward to. Yeah, that's very exciting. Go for it, Amy. Freedom, freedom. So Colossians 3 is the next one. I'm going to be all over scripture tonight, so if you want to try to flip, by all means, you can. If not, I made a whole bunch of slides because I am very scripture heavy tonight. So Colossians 3, 1-4. So if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things above where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. For you died and your life is hidden away with Christ in God. For Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also, I don't know if I'm reading that right, I'm dyslexic moment. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will also will appear with him in glory. All right. Seeing our earthly suffering is essential in our spiritual growth helps us set our mind on things above. So I have a question for you, and you can just shout out the answer. What are some ways you set your mind on things above, or things that you can set your mind on? How do you set your mind on things above? James. Awesome. Worship, music, and prayer. Love those. Those are two of my favorites. All right. Anything else? Reading the Bible. All right. Oh, Alyssa. Hey, that was a good one for you. You scored nature on the sacred pathways, didn't you? Yeah, yeah. All right. Anybody use anything else? Is there a particular way you'd like to worship that you feel comfortable sharing? No. At any of you like focusing on things above through art? Anyone? Yeah, I thought maybe. How about through dance? Maybe, yeah. All right. Some people through reading other things that aren't the Bible but are scriptural. And I have one that my family's kind of obsessed with, and that's Adventures in Odyssey. I know there's some of you in here that set your mind on things above with that, too. There can be multiple ways to set your mind on things above. And when we're in the midst of suffering, but we can think about the things above, it helps us to realize that this world is temporary. The suffering is temporary. Did we somehow get poor Penelope locked out? Oh, man. All right. So I want to talk a little bit about someone who went through some suffering. So I'm going to give you a brief overview of the life of Joseph. If you're curious to read in the Bible Joseph's life in detail, it's Genesis 37 to 50. So it's many, many chapters. That's why we're not reading it right now. But if you want to read Joseph's life, take note, Genesis 37 to 50. But I'm going to give you the Marcie paraphrased version of Joseph's life. Here we go. Joseph is the 11th of 12 sons, and he was his daddy's favorite. His brothers got jealous. Shocker, because dad was pretty clear Joseph was his favorite. He didn't even hide it well, like those of us who have a favorite kid, but like pretend that we don't. Mm-hmm. No, we don't, right, Julie? We do not have a favorite child. All right. So his dad was pretty blatant with his favoritism, and so his brothers got really jealous. Then Joseph has a dream. And his brothers bound, and that in and of itself, he went and told his brothers, and that made them even more jealous. So then they decide to do what? Who knows? Decide to kill him. Instead, one of them said, "Let's sell him into slavery." So first they said, "Let's kill him. We throw him into a well. Then we pull him out and we sell him into slavery." So you're both correct. So obviously. Seems kind of suffering to me. Then he sold into slavery and he ends up. Pharaoh starts to notice that everything Joseph is in charge of. So he puts him in charge of more and he really likes him. Unfortunately, so does Pharaoh's wife. So So then Joseph gets accused of some stuff that he didn't do with Pharaoh's wife. And if you don't know what that is, go read Genesis 37 to 50. All right? And so he gets thrown into prison for something he did not do. In fact, he was standing very strong in his faith and standing up for what is right, and he still landed himself into prison. And he's in prison. He, again, gets favor from the guards. He's, like, put in charge of other prisoners. And these two prisoners have dreams. Then Joseph interprets them. That comes true. He's like, don't forget me. Tell Pharaoh. Well, they forget, and they don't tell Pharaoh. 2 years, I think, goes by, and then Pharaoh has a dream. And one of the guys, whose dream he interprets, because the other one's dead, if you don't know that story, read Genesis 37 to 50. All right? The one of the guys is still alive, and he goes, oh, yeah, you know what? There was this guy I was in prison with. He can interpret dreams. So they pull Joseph out of prison. He interprets Pharaoh's dream. Pharaoh's like, that's awesome. But the dream is bad, because the dream is there will be 7 years of plenty and then 7 years of famine. And then Pharaoh's like, okay, well, guess what, Joseph? I'm going to put you in charge of all the food, and you get to make sure that we are well prepared for and that we don't die of starvation. Kind of a big job description, but Joseph pulls it off, and he's able to preserve enough food that not only all of Egypt is safe, but people from outside of Egypt come in for food. And some of those people happen to be his brothers, those stinking 10 brothers that threatened to kill him and then sold him into slavery. They come for food. And long story short, in the end, Joseph forgives them, reveals who he is, and says, you meant this for evil, but God meant it for good. Suffering, leading to good. Now, Joseph did not have the New Testament to cling to like we do. Yet he trusted that God was using the bad for good. And his bad lasted a long time. I couldn't find exactly how long Joseph served with Pharaoh the first time before he went into prison. But he was 17 when his brother sold him. And he was 39 when his brothers came to get grain the first time. So between 17 and 39, at least, he was stuck in Egypt. And for part of that time, I don't know how long he was in prison. And Joseph was 56 when his dad passed away. So he missed a lot of years with his dad. What God meant for good might not have been what Joseph or even his dad would have thought of as good, because this thing that God orchestrated for him to do meant losing almost 40 years with his dad. I mean, he was his dad's favorite. He lost 40 years with him. It also meant not hanging out with his beloved brother Benjamin, who ended up being the 12th of the brothers, and he got to see him later. He requested that his brothers bring him, but he missed out on and hanging out with his little brother Benjamin. It meant living in a foreign land and not marrying a Jewish woman, which might not seem like much, but that was a really big deal to them back then, that he married an Egyptian and not a Jewish woman. And yet, Joseph considered it all for good. One of, course, the biggest people we think of for suffering, Jesus, right? He chose to come to earth. He lived with much persecution. He suffered injustice and was killed. But what was the good? Why did Jesus do that? Yay, that's a good thing. Whoa, we don't have to go to hell. Yes, we don't. We have our salvation because Jesus suffered and died. If he hadn't done that, we would not have our salvation. So, Romans 8:28 said, we know that all things work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose. Let us consider resting in the promise that God is working for our good. I often hear Christian circles throw that verse around, like, oh, something bad happens. All things work together for good for those who are called according to God's purpose. Like that's some magic spell that's going to make you feel better when you were in a car accident, or your family, somebody gets diagnosed with cancer, or something bad happens, just hearing that scripture is not going to magically make you feel better. But it is a promise that even when the things of this world don't look good, God is working. And we might not see it in our lifetime. And that can be the hard part to wrap our earthly brains around. And it leads to groaning and complaining when we suffer. All right. So, Romans 8:24. Now, in this hope, we were saved. But hope that is seen is not hope. Because who hopes for what he sees? Now, if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with patience. So, back in June, my birthday was back in June, and it was the Wednesday night was the night before my birthday, and I was out there, and I can't remember who I was talking to, but there was a couple people out there talking to me, and I said, every year my husband gets me an ice cream cake, and I was standing there, and I said, he had better bring home an ice cream cake. And whoever was out there with me is like, boy, he's going to be in trouble if he doesn't. They're like, should we let him know? I was like, no, he'll remember. Like, he always gets me a birthday cake. That was my hope. I was really, really, really hoping for an ice cream cake. I love those little crunchy things in between the ice cream layers, you know. We love our ice cream cakes. When that cake came out of the freezer, had its candles on it, the kids and the children were singing to me, I didn't have to hope for that cake anymore, right? It was right there. I knew I had it. I didn't have to hope because it was right in front of me. I had hoped beforehand. So we don't hope for what is right in front of us. We hope for what's eternal, what we can't see, what is unseen. In verse 26 and 27 says, in the same way, the Spirit also helps us in our weakness. Because we do not know what to pray for as we should. But the Spirit himself intercedes for us with inexpressible groanings. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit. Because he intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. They may know what interceding is. I'm glad you asked. I looked up the... Oh, James, do you know? It's exactly going between. That is the exact definition. Well, that's what you were going to say, right, Corbin? I knew it was. All right. It is a verb. It means to intervene between parties with a view of reconciling differences. The Latin word sidere, I don't take Latin, means to go or to go between. So the literal meaning of intercede is to go between. So the Spirit intercedes between us and God. Show of hands. How many of you have ever not known what to pray for or how to pray for something? Maybe it's because the situation's overwhelming, so you don't know where to start praying. Maybe it seems hopeless. Maybe you can't find the words to express what's in your heart. Or even sometimes we can't figure out how we feel about a situation to pray for it. Even Paul said at one point, rather should I ask to live and keep spreading the gospel, or should I ask to die and go be with the Lord, basically, paraphrasing Paul. So he was like, he didn't even know which one to ask for. Sometimes we don't know. And I can admit, when my niece got cancer the first time, I was praying for her. The second time and the third time, it kept getting harder and harder to trust God that he would heal her. And even had times when I was like, well, does God want to heal her? Well, is it God to heal her? There are many been sick that I haven't known how to pray for her, what I should pray for, or what that looks like, or even had that confidence would come true. But praise God, someone does. Someone knows how to pray. The Holy Spirit, he groans for us. Jesus sits at the right hand of the Father interceding for us. They both know how to pray. Jesus and the Holy Spirit know how to pray. They have the right words, and they know the will of God, so they know in God's will to something happen. like, oh God, do you want Korah healed? Or are you going to use this somehow? I mean, all things work together for those who love God and are called according. So there I go between. A long while back, Pastor Wayne did a great sermon, in my personal opinion, great sermon about a prayer language or tongues and his experience with it. And if you want to go back and listen to it, if you've never heard it or you want to listen to it a second time, it was back in February 2020, and it was called Other Tongues, and it truly is one of the best sermons I've ever listened to on the spiritual gift of tongues and the prayer language of tongues. And I want to touch on that prayer language tonight. And I do. I really encourage you to listen to it. Back in February 2020, you can go on to our YouTube channel, Hopewell's YouTube channel, and type into search, and it'll pop up. Type in Other Tongues or February 2020. You can also just type in Wayne and search through all of his. That's how I found it. One important way of letting the Holy Spirit groan for you is to just ask him. And it isn't like some gibberish. Like a lot of times people think speaking in tongues, it's hard. And if you have never learned about it and you're like, I have no idea what you're talking about right now, Marcie, I encourage you to talk to one of us leaders afterwards or study it for yourself. But there is a spiritual gift called tongues, and typically it comes in a couple different forms. One is actually speaking languages that are for real, but you don't know. And I have had that experience where I was able to speak and understand Spanish on a mission trip when I don't speak or understand Spanish, as my children can attest. And I also have a prayer language of tongues. And I don't use it that often. And to paraphrase Pastor Wayne, it doesn't feel natural because it's supernatural. And it is something that I use when I can't express in human words my thoughts or my emotions or my distress or my words. I don't know. And so I just sit and I just kind of quiet before the Lord. A lot of times I'll sit with my hands out and just breathe and just let the Spirit. And sometimes gibberish does come out of my mouth, but I trust that is the Holy Spirit interceding for me. All right. So let's see. In the next, I'm going to read a little more scripture. If God is for us, who is against us? He did not even spare his own son, but gave him up for all of us. How will he not also grant us everything? Who can bring an accusation against God's elect? God is the one who justifies. He is the one who condemns. Who is the one who condemns? Jesus Christ is the one who died, but even more has been raised. He also sits at the right hand of God and intercedes for us. So the Holy Spirit will help between you and God pray. And then also Jesus is sitting there right beside God praying for us. Can affliction or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth nor anything in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. All right, so I know that was a lot. That was a lot of stuff tonight. So I condensed it down to like basically 2 points for you. All right, point number one. Difficult times have a purpose. They can sometimes last a very long time. But we have hope, a hope for a future with God. Point number one. And point number two, I hope you take away. We have help. We have help from the Holy Spirit when we need guidance, help from Jesus Christ sitting in the right hand of God interceding for us. We have help from God, our Heavenly Father, who loves us, created us, knows us, and chose us. And I know that was a lot, but I hope you get those two things. And if you're like, okay, that whole like tongues prayer language thing you briefly talked about is something I would like to like pray about or know more about or talk about, Wayne and Amy have agreed to be back there in that prayer corner after small groups, and they can pray for you or talk with you a little bit more about that. You can also, of course, find another leader too, but they're going to really be back there focusing on those who want prayed for to God to intercede for a prayer language. That is not the only way to get a prayer language, by having someone pray for you. That is not how I acquired it, but I know there are people that do, and I know that I trust that Amy and Wayne are incredible prayers. They're really prayer warriors, and so I'm really thankful that they're willing to.